Today, before we get started, I want to just do a little explaining about how important the right material is for a lot of these flies. I don't know if you've noticed, I have not spent a lot of time on that, but maybe one of the reasons some of my woolly boogers look a little bit better is I know how to pick material. The marabou itself, there's some good stuff. If you buy a package of marabou, there's going to be a bunch of waste in that package. It won't have the fluffy, thick contour that you want for a tail. The pattern that we're going to be doing today, this Griffith's Gnat, it's an easy fly to tie if you have the right hackle. If you don't have the right hackle, it will be frustrating. I've got a couple of saddles here, and I don't know if you can see from there. This is a hackle that is comes with a, you'll get a feather off of it that looks something like this. For some patterns, that's a great feather. For a Griffith's Gnat, that's terrible. What you want is a saddle similar to this, and look at the difference in the hackle. This hackle is going to be pretty much universal, the same size, width from the stem, both sides, all the way up that. Naturally, this stuff is the most expensive. You can spend $25 or $30 at Cabela's for a very small section of this that may have maybe 15, maybe 20 of these in a package if you're lucky. But if you want a fly that looks really nice, this material is going to be really important, especially for this particular fly. I've tied a 16, a 14, and a 12 over here. And you can tell by looking at the fly, if I had, I don't think I have here. This, see if I can show you this. If you bend this,
zoom out a little bit. It's out of focus.
You can see the length of those barbs. This one would probably work for a 12, maybe a 14. But if you have a size 16 hook, it's going to be way too long. So when you're, that's why I selected some hackle up here in two sizes. I plucked some stuff out that's going to work better for a 12, and some that's going to work better for a 14. So the larger diameter or distance of the hackle is going to be work better for the 12, smaller for the 14. So I wanted to give you that background. And a couple words about peacock curl. Some of the stuff is absolutely worthless. Some of the stuff we have in stock has been around a while. It's good looking peacock curl, but it's been in stock long enough that it gets brittle. Something that I will often do if I think my hackle or my peacock curl is going to be a little bit brittle, I will just put it in my mouth, soak up that center stem, because it's going to break on the stem, and just let that saliva kind of soften that a little bit, and I'll have a better chance of that bending when I start wrapping rather than breaking. But if all of these little strands are not the same, so when I tie this fly on a size 12, I will get four or five strands. I may pick out six or seven, and of that six or seven, there will be one or two that just not very thick along the stem. It's going to have minimal color coverage, and it's just going to be bulky, and it's not going to do anything for the fly. So I will start trying to do a little bit more information on materials as we get further into the season, but I wanted to mention that. This little fly, I have caught a lot of trout in the spring trip or the summer trip. I sometimes go to Rockbridge, you know, three or four times a year. I'll take my grandkids up, and the later in the year when the terrestrials are out and about, you can have a heyday there if they're up slurping stuff on the top of the water. And this fly is a killer. I brought with me, this is the stuff that I use. It's called Aquell, and it's a loon product. And all it is it comes, it's kind of, it looks like that stuff we used on the woolly bugger. It comes out in kind of a very thick, clear, but it's not UV sensitive at all. It is nothing, but it's going to make that fly float a lot longer. It's a floatant material. And I have found with this that I got to be careful. If I put two doses of this on a fly, I can't get it to sink. And there are days when the trout are going to want something. After about five or six casts with one treatment, it's going to kind of just hang right below the surface, and that's the way they want it. And if you got one that's going to stay on the top, they'll ignore it all day long. So I've got to figure out a way to put some kind of a system where I can say, this is a one coat, this is a two coat on my vest, and I haven't figured out how to do that yet. But there are all kinds of products out there. I've just started with this, and I stuck with it because it works for me. But a little bottle like this, well, I've had this for 4 or 5 years. It doesn't take much for it to do the job. So I've treated all these. If you forget, as you false cast with a fly rod, it'll dry the fly out, and then you drop on the water. And if you've done that 4 or 5 casts, it'll sink quicker the fifth cast than it does the first cast. It gets to where it absorbs enough moisture that it will sink. So if you don't put anything on, it's going to sink pretty quickly and stay down. So that's why I use a floatant on this fly. Now, probably know this, but a dry fly hook, if you notice the diameter of the metal in these hooks, it's considerably smaller. It's probably you'll see on a hook package, a 1X fine. That means the wire in it is one size smaller in terms of weight than like a standard hook. And they do that to give it more floatability. So you can tie these with a nymph hook, but boy, you'll need some floating for sure. So if you're going to do a dry fly, you'll be better off using a dry fly hook.